So looking at 1 Corinthians chapter 4 and verses 1, this is a continuation of a number of different things we have covered as far as the first chapter, where we saw Paul putting a great emphasis onto the message that is to do with the cross of Christ. And one more other thing that he also made that was very important that we considered in the first chapter is the issue that is to do with how Christ is the power of God, and that power of God is one of the things that people look down upon. We also realize that because of the cross of Christ, all of us have been called. We that were unfitting, we that were weak, we that were foolish, all of us have been called by the cross of Christ. And that is a tremendous thing for us to do or to consider. In chapter 2, Paul went on to give a testimony how he went to the Corinthians, choosing not to know any other thing among the Corinthians except Christ and him being crucified. And that is the message of the church. If Christ was not crucified, every person that talks about the resurrection would not have been a possibility. But the resurrection is a possibility simply because one day Jesus had to go to the cross of Calvary and do the work that he did up there after atoning for our sins. Today we are very more than confident that same man that was crucified and later on was raised from the world of the dead, he has promised us that even our mortal bodies shall be done what? Shall be raised from the dust of the earth. More into that, Paul also explained that he went to the Corinthians in weakness and in much trembling. But though he had a lot of body ills, that did not stop him from sharing the gospel. He shared it the way it had to be shared. And he went on to express himself in writing that the rulers of this world were not wise enough to know that their crucifying of Christ was actually a crucifixion of the Lord Jesus, the King of glory, and it was hidden from them by the purpose of the Lord. And later on we came to realize that everything that pertains to all of those that were mysteries that our eyes had not seen, that everything that is to do with our hearts had not imagined, that is what the Lord has prepared for us. And everything that is to do with that is now fulfilled in the work of Christ and all that he did by revealing this tremendous truth to the apostles. We realize that we also now have the Spirit of the Lord simply because now we are children of the Lord and now we are able to understand all things. And in chapter 3, we made a number of important points, and one of it was to know that indeed to a church that has a lot of contention, strife and envy amongst them, that basically means that is a sign of a church actually being in an infant stage where we are doing things that are not supposed to be done in the body of Christ. And Paul said to the Corinthians, since they had a lot of fightings amongst themselves, he said he would not feed them on solid food. Rather, he chose to feed them on milk, and milk stands for the elementary teachings that one has to know about the doctrine of Christ. And then he went on to express his point more as to why he chose to feed them on milk. If some of them were saying that they were belonging to Paul, and some were belonging to Peter, and some were belonging to Apollos, that alone would mean that they were indeed babies. And he went on to discourage them to have men that they should actually apportion themselves to as party leaders, saying that I belong to the party of Paul, I belong to the party of Apollos, and I belong to the party of Peter. He said that is not good. It is God who worketh with us, and all an increase comes from the Lord Jesus Christ. That is the same thing that should be done in our modern day church, where we do not look at ministers as masters, as lords, who actually should receive the outstanding praise, but all the praise should go out to the Lord. Still in chapter 3, Paul also explained that the same Lord who worketh with us is the same Lord that is going to reward us, where all our works are going to be tested by fire, and whoever will have his work not be able to go through the fires of the judgment seat of Christ, that person will not be able to receive any reward. But those that will have their work in the accordance to the pattern of gold, to the material of silver and precious stones, those are the ones that will receive a reward. Those are the ones that will receive a crown from the Lord. But whoever tries to build on the foundation of Christ with substances that are to do with wood, hay, and straw, all of those, the Bible says, will not be able to stand the fire, though an individual himself will be saved. And the Bible says, whoever misuses the body of the Lord will be consumed, because our bodies have become the temple of the Holy Spirit. So whatever we do in these bodies should be for the glory of the name of our Father. And that is very important. So Paul went on to make an emphasis to show that all the things belong to us, whether it is Paul teaching, whether it is Apollos, whether it is Peter, whether it is some other person. Their appearance was not the most important thing. The most important thing is that God has made all things for us, and Christ is for us the same way Christ belongeth unto the Father, and everything in the world is for us. So that was the main thing that the gentleman made so very much clear. And the size of the work is not the main thing that Paul said that we should put our focus on to, but the quality that is to do with us being faithful with what the Lord has called us to do. So now let us look at chapter 4, where I want us to concentrate. In chapter 4, Paul begins, that is actually the same division message that started in chapter 1, in chapter 2, and chapter 3, continues through actually chapter 4. And in chapter 4, that is where we're going to have the last or the end of the discussion that is to do with the exalting ministers, with the issues of also divisions, with the issues of things to do with the strength that is based on to who belongs to each person and all of that. So this is where it all ends, and Paul summarizes each and everything. But remember, in the original canon, there was no chapter, there was no any division. The divisions that are to do with chapters and verses were put in by men. So this was actually one single letter. However, to some extent, the chapter divisions, some in one way or the other, they also enable us to know where we may have done what stopped. So chapter 4 verses 1 starts by saying, I'm using ESV version and King James. This is how one should regard us as servants of Christ. Very important. This is how one should regard us as servants of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God. The main thing that Paul makes in verses 1 that needs you and I to pay close attention to, he's actually making a simple emphasis onto them being looked upon as what? As servants of Christ. The challenge of the Corinthians is the same challenge we see today, where we elevate ministers above them being what? Servants. And then we see them as what? Party leaders. We see them as what? Lords. We see them as what? As masters. He says this is how one should regard us as what? As servants of Christ. The challenge with a modern day church, we have elevated the ministers and we have diminished Christ. The moment you elevate the minister, Christ will be diminished. The message to the church of the Corinthians is not limited to the believers in the church of Corinth. It is an extended message to all the churches that came after the apostolic era. And so, my dear ones, Kenneth, Alex, and all of us, when we are relating with one another or with some other person that is a minister, let us see them as what? Servants of Christ. Altogether, know this issue of lifting an individual beyond his position. They should be respected as ministers, but we should not overrate them. We should not overvalue them to a point of what we have now seen in the news. People kissing their feet, people kneeling down to them, people caring for them, this and all of that. Paul says this is how one should regard us as servants. Remember the main thing Jesus came to do, what? To serve. Altogether. So all they that are ministers of Christ should do what? Should be seen as what? Servants. They should not be seen as what? Lords. They should not be seen as what? Masters. But now the church has taken this thing out of its context. That is why we think today a minister has received a more outstanding anointing than the believers. That is where we think that the minister hears from the Lord more than all the congregants. But remember, the best place and to where the Lord speaks to all of us from is what? His word. But if you don't see a minister as a servant of Christ, you think that he has something more than you do have. The only thing the minister should in one way that be seen in is he has become the mouthpiece of the word of God. But the one who should be a mouthpiece of the word of God is now, if he's now taken beyond that, that is where the error does what? Comes in. Altogether, so ministers, according to 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 1, altogether, should be esteemed by their flocks as what? Good stewards. Altogether, if there is any respect people should give you, they should esteem you as what? A good what? Steward of what? Of the mysteries of God. The word mystery remains the revealed truth. God has made this truth to be done what? Revealed unto us. Remember, everything that was hidden has now been made manifest to us by the writing of the apostles. So, if any minister cannot be seen as a steward of God's mystery, then that person is a false what? Is a false minister. True ministers of the Lord should be what? Stewards of the mysteries of God. Altogether. And now, that's something that is very substantial. If you don't see them as stewards of God's mysteries, is why you're going to do what? To give them more praises that go beyond what they should receive from you. And like I said last week, you cannot read from the book of the Corinthians and then you allow a lot of the nonsense that you see in the modern day church. Paul says, let men regard us as servants. That means minus Christ, someone is not what? A minister. But now one thing that is happening today, one wants to be actually elevated above the name of what? Jesus. But we all know from Philippians chapter what? Chapter 2, verses 8 to verses 10, it is Christ's name that is lifted above all what? Other names. So, what I can say as far as summary of verses 1 that is very important for you and I to understand, we should esteem ministers as what? Stewards of what? God's mysteries. And we all know who a steward is. A steward takes care of what? Of another's what? Another's work. Altogether. So he doesn't give instructions that go beyond what was told of him. However, he makes sure that he manages everything that is to do with another person's work. Is that what you're seeing today in the church? Instead of people managing, instead of people doing things the way the Lord has called them to do it, they have now gone what? Beyond. Altogether. Verses 2 adds in to say what? Moreover, it is required of stewards that they be found what? Trustworthy. Who is a genuine minister? A genuine minister should be what? Should be faithful. Should be what? Faithful with God's mysteries. That is why I have always taught and I'm saying again, we should discourage the issue that is known as the devil's algebra. People adding to the word of God by subtracting from it. People subtracting from the word of God by doing what? By adding to it. That should not happen. That's why he says, moreover, it is required in stewards that a man be found faithful. If we are not faithful with God's word, therefore God cannot entrust us with things that are ours. Altogether, because you being given another person's thing to take a full oversight over it, if you're not faithful with it, then how can you be trusted with what is yours? Because if you have no fear for what belongs to another person, therefore what belongs to you will say, I can do whatever I want, no one will do what, will say anything to me. That's why Paul says, moreover, it is required in stewards that a man be found faithful. And that is one thing that is very important to each and every one of us. Every responsibility you have, out together, be it small or big, let us all be what? Faithful, because we know at the end of it all, someday when you and I die and we are raised, the Lord will reward us in the accordance to our faithfulness. The Lord is not going to reward any person that was a busybody, a person that was not faithful. Everything, if you're a housewife, if you're a husband, if you're a carpenter, if you do any work you do, be faithful with one thing that has been done, what? Entrusted to you altogether. And so that is the plea of Paul to the Corinthians, them being what? Faithful. And that's the same thing, that the duty and the interest of every minister is to be what? Is to be faithful. If you find a minister who is not faithful with what he's supposed to do, just know something is not what? Is not right. Altogether? So, that's a test for it. Now, in the King James still here, it makes the same point of say that stewards should be what? Should be faithful. Altogether? So, everything that is put under your care, you need to make sure that you are what? You are faithful. The challenge you have today is that people who are not faithful, they fulfill 2 Corinthians 2:17. What does it say? It says, "For we are not as many which corrupt the word of God." That's a person that is not faithful. And today the corruption we see has included a number of things to do with CD faith, positive confession, things to do with lighting candles on people's heads, that as the candles melt, their problems are going to melt. Feeding people on raw serpents, feeding people on grass, kissing the minister's feet, all of that nonsense, selling the anointing oil, whatever, bottles, and all of that nonsense. Those are individuals that are what? That are not faithful. However, they do what? They corrupt the word of God. Paul says, "For we are not as many which corrupt the word of God, but as of sincerity, but as of God, in sight of God, we speak in what? In Christ." Altogether, faithfulness is very important. 2 Corinthians 4:2. What does it say? One of the marks that will show that one is faithful as a minister of Christ, this is one of the things the Bible adds in to say in 2 Corinthians 4:2. It says, "But have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty." You don't have to enter ministry because you are entering ministry to earn a living. You don't have to enter ministry because you want to take advantage of people, coming up with techniques, coming up with skills, coming up with formulas of wanting to steal from people. The Lord has said to me, he said, "The Lord never said anything to you." The Bible says true ministers have done what? Renounce the hidden things of dishonesty. Not walking in what? Craftiness. No, what? Handling the word of God deceitfully. There are so many pulpits of error where God's word has been what? Handled in a deceitful way. Altogether, they read things out of context. Now, an example, you all know it. Mark chapter 4, verses 14. The Bible says that the sower soweth what? The word. Now, today, that sowing of the word has turned into money. Mm. You sow 500,000. Mm. You sow 200,000. You sow all this and all of that. So, that is one thing that has to do with what we call what? People handling God's word in craftiness, in a deceitful what? Manner. Paul says that should not happen to any person who says that you are what? You are a minister of the Lord Jesus Christ. Out together. So that's a keeper that we should not be what? We should not take that we should not take for granted. In verse 3, First Corinthians 4, verse 3, it says, "But with me it is a very small thing." Let us understand why is he saying what he's saying. "That I should be judged of you," meaning they were doing what? Judging him altogether. "That I should be judged of you or of any man's judgment. Yes, I judge not my own self." What Paul is saying, he was not caring about how people were looking at him. You see, today, people actually have gone into issues of preference. "I like Pastor so-and-so because of his looks. I like Pastor so-and-so because of his tangible wealth," altogether. And that's the same thing that Corinthians were doing. They were actually following particular ministers based on their external what? Factors. Is he very eloquent? Is he a rich man? How does he appear? And all of that nonsense. So Paul says that, "But with me it is a small thing." And that's the same thing I'm saying to all of us. The opinion of men does not do what? Matter. Altogether. What matters is what God thinks about us. Altogether. Whether people judge you like this, all that, God is the final judge. Altogether. If they say you don't measure up, if they say that you are not this, you are not all of that, that should not be yours. Jesus is the one who knows our hearts. And if he knows our hearts, is the one that can pass a rightful judgment over each and every one of us. But if you go on accepting people's judgment, so one thing Paul is doing, he's discouraging a premature judgment that people pass on to one another, that people pass on to ministers. That should not be done. The right time is coming when the Lord will judge all things altogether. That's why he says that, as for me, I take it as a light thing. Altogether, I take it as a light thing. Why should I be in that? In verses 4, he adds in to say, for I know nothing. Look at that. For I know nothing by myself. Altogether, yet I am not hereby justified, but he that judgeth me is who? Is the Lord. Altogether, he nails the fine nail into the coffin by saying, the best person to judge us, if they were going by a particular individual, people belonging to Paul, people belonging to all of that, Paul said all of those are bad judgments. Altogether, the one that judges in the good way is none other than the Lord. Look at verses 5. Therefore, judge nothing before what? Time. Altogether, judge nothing before time. Remember also where we also came from, where people consider what? The size of the work. Mm-hmm. So people will always go out with their praises. I think because someone has this, that person is going to receive more from the Lord. No. Paul says, no, judge nothing before the time. The appearance of something can actually lead you to think that indeed God is in it, but you wait. Why should you wait? Look at the next word. He says what? Judge nothing before time until what? The Lord cometh. Who does what? Who both will do what? Bring to light the hidden things. Even if it is a marriage where we cover things, even if it is some church where we don't know what they do in the secret there, the Lord will bring everything to what? To light. So, none of us should lie to ourselves by anything external, and none of us should give any praises to men before time. It's a key word I'm saying again. None of us should give any praises to men before time. Don't be deceived by the size of someone's ministry. Don't be deceived by someone's work or anything of that sort. Paul says, when the Lord cometh in his rightful time, he will bring both to light the hidden things of darkness and will make what? Manifest. What? The counsels of what? Of the hearts. And what? See, all of these four things that we have always been talking about, the false ministers and all of that. You know, some people might say, you know what? You people, you are fond of critiquing and actually criticizing and all of that. But let me tell you, the counsel of it all, the reward of all of us, it is actually going to be determined by one single word, individual. And that man is none other than who? Christ. And that is why Paul adds in to say, he will make manifest the counsel of the hearts, and then shall what? Every man have what? Have the praise of what? Of God. Do you know there are people that have already received the praise of God of men, and they are not going to receive the praise of God? Some people have already received what? The praise of men, because they do not want the praise of what? Of God. But I'm telling you, all of us should be humble to seek and to look forward to the praise that come from who? From God. Are we together? Mm-hmm. Why? The praises of men are what? Are temporal. Mm-hmm. Are we together? They are short-lived. But the praise of him that brings all things to light, even the hidden things of darkness, the one that maketh manifest the counsels of the hearts of men, that one, when he says, I have accepted, I have endorsed what you did, the Bible says that is the praise that will be what? That will be such a glorious what? Praise. Just come to think about this. With all of the celebrity ministers, with all people at different places of work whom we don't know what they have done for them to receive more and more actually promotions, in a number of different circles, in a number of different places where people are, and they are doing things, we all don't know what the secrets, we all don't know the counsels that are to do with their hearts. But whoever you see, whoever you're not able to tell, people say God hid the hearts. Yes, this is the answer why he hid the hearts. He hid the hearts so that in the right time he can reveal to you and I altogether what was hidden. Don't worry that I don't know what is in his heart. Don't worry about it. You deal with them. You work with them. But in the rightful time, if you're working with an individual who was actually to turn around to stab you and you didn't know that he was working around to stab you, that day shall manifest it all. Altogether, so I don't need to know what is in a person's heart. All I know, I am trusting in the Lord, and someday he will bring to light everything that is hidden in the hearts of all men. Whether I am a minister, whether someone is not a minister, all of us, wherever God has called us unto, whatever we are doing, people may not be knowing, but God is going to bring everything to what? To light. Altogether. Mm-hmm. When you hear songs that you do with Bayuda Twitter, don't worry with Bayuda Twitter. The day is coming when the Lord is going to do what? To reveal. Altogether. That revelation is coming. And I'm telling you, God does not give you the ability to know what is in the heart of another. Mm. Altogether, even if they do us bad, people have bewitched other people's children and all of that. We don't know why they do what they do. Altogether. But I'm telling you that they shall bring everything to light. And the one that rewards will reward all of us according to our works. Let us broaden this. This is not only into ministry. Everything you and I do, if you've accumulated wealth by lying, by stealing, by doing a number of different things, or you involving yourself in witchcraft, that day shall make it all what? Plain. And this alone will discourage you and I to wanting to do what? To compete with one another. Let us not try to compete with people. Just be faithful with what the Lord has put in your hand. Whether it is big or small, just be what? Faithful. Altogether. Because the surface of all things, in fact, even in the English, they say that not everything that glitters is what? Is gold. The surface of something might lie to you. Altogether. And now today, talking from the side where I am so much into ministry, when we see something big for us, we say, yeah, that man has the hand of the Lord upon him. But you don't know the heart. Altogether, you don't know everything, things that are done behind the scenes. You don't know all of those things, and you don't need to know them. Altogether, you concentrate on your work, and as you concentrate on your work, there is where we are going all to meet. And I'm telling you, the final word about this is what? Seeking what? The praises of what? Of God. But I'm telling you, this takes the Spirit of the Lord to have attention unto this. Many people are looking for what? For the praises of what? Of men. Altogether? So, even if they say, Museum 7 is very old, he needs to retire, he says, people still like me. Altogether. When praises of men are still there, you still do what? Compete. Altogether. So, look at verses 7. I mean 6. 6 in ESV says, I have applied all the things to myself and Apollos for your benefit. Now, look at this one very carefully. When the Corinthians went into the issue of putting their party leaders, masters and lords, belonging to Paul, to Apollos, to Cephas, was it the same thought of the apostles? Because the apostle is saying, I have applied all the things to myself and Apollos for your benefit. They never taught what they never practiced. But it is with our followers that do what? Overrate and overvalue the ministers. We over-exaggerate them. I think so-and-so is better than so-and-so. I think so is better than so. It is us that have always come up with that. And now the challenge is, though the ministers may not have been the main idea behind it, is their problem is them not doing what? Stopping the people. Mm-hmm. Altogether. And say, that should not be done. And the fact that they should not, they don't stop it, is because they also enjoy to be done what? Praised of men. Altogether. Remember one time when we were looking at Herod. Herod, people began to say, this is the voice of God. Little did he know that the slap was going to come unto him. And the angel of the Lord just came and did what? And slapped him, and worms began doing what? Falling off his what? His body. So God does not want us to take his place. All the honor and the glory belongeth unto who? Unto God alone. So Paul says, I have applied all these things to myself and Apollos for your benefit, brothers. Were they believers? Yes. And he adds in to say what? That you may learn by us not to go beyond that which is what? Written, that none of you may be puffed up in favor against one another. Isn't that the same thing we are seeing? The challenge is, if we do not live biblically, if we don't follow the writings of the scripture, is why we keep on inventing new things, to elevate our ministers. You'll never find people who are biblically sound trying to come up with an idea that the Bible does not do what? Endorse. Altogether. So that is why it says, after having applied it to myself and to who? And to Apollos. We urge you also not to do what? To exalt any man above that which is written. Now think of all things that you and I know as things that the Bible does not allow. What is the main thing behind it? People have done what? Gone above what? Above that which is written. And then another thing that they have done is to do what? Is to puff one person against what? Another. Yet Paul says what? That the true praise comes from who? From the Lord. When you read everything in context, everything comes out what? Clearly. Without any what? Without any exaggeration. So none of us, no any Christian should try to do what? To exalt any person above another. Let us consider 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians chapter 10 and the verses 12. What does the apostle say? It says, for we dare not to make ourselves of a number or compare ourselves that we commend commend themselves, but they measuring themselves by themselves and comparing themselves among themselves are not what? Wise. So there is a lot of thing that is to do with people not exercising the true wisdom simply because of what? Going above that which is what? Written. Every time you compare this person with another person, the Bible says it is not what? It is not wise. And what is not wise has become a normative in the church. The church is so very much open and to doing things which are not what? Which are not acceptable. And why is the church exalting a number of things which are not acceptable? It is because the church has not gone back to the writing. The church has not gone back to the book. The church has left. The church has forsook the apostolic writings altogether. And the main thing actually always goes back to the leaders, because it is the leaders that should channel the followers in the right way. But since the leaders themselves are seeking to be puffed one against another, is why they cannot rebuke those that do what? That come up with such ideas. The Bible says it is not a wise thing. And let me tell you, if the Bible says it is not a wise thing, thereof it means it is not what? It is not wise. We should not see good where God sees no what? Good. Altogether. Because everything we do have today, it is the Lord who has done what? Who has given unto us. Why should we exalt ourselves above others? That is basically a Pharisaical thing. Let us look at Matthew. Matthew 23:8. The scripture says in Matthew 23:8, but be ye not called Rabbi, for one is your master, even Christ, and all ye are brethren. Verses 9. And call no man your father upon the earth, for one is your father which is in heaven, neither be you called what? Masters. Now, I think in context of 1 Corinthians and with what we have seen, is Paul right to say that let men regard as servants of what? Mm-hmm. But the ones that are supposed to be servants of the others, they have now become what? Masters altogether, which the Lord does what? Forbids. And that is a Pharisaical attitude, always doing what? Coming up with things that are not aligning with what? With the scriptures. The Bible says that should not be done what? Thought about. Look at Romans 12:3. For I say, through the grace given unto me, that every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God has done what? Dealt with every man the measure of faith. Altogether, the Bible discourages the issue of one doing what? Setting himself above what? Others. When you hear people saying that they are belonging to this group, they are belonging to the other group, and the other one is their main man, those are all things the Bible says that they are not true. Those are things that we should leave for the Church of Rome with its word, with its Pope. But all of us that have come to know the writing of the scripture, we are all put under one leadership, and that is the leadership of a man on us who? Jesus Christ. If you put yourself under any other leadership other than the leadership of Jesus Christ, you're going to be deceived. Men will lead you what? Astray, which the Bible says should not be what? It is not a good thing. So I understand that now the term we have taught from 1 Corinthians 4:6, you know the importance of 1 Corinthians 4:6. Everything should not go above that which is what? Written. But in 7 it says, "For who maketh you to differ from another?" They are talking to us. The ones that go on doing what? Elevating one against another. What makes you to do what? To differ from another. Altogether. What have you that you did not receive? Altogether. And now if you did receive it, why do you glory as if you had not received? What is the point of Paul? We have no good but what we have done, what? Received. Altogether. But all of us who have received, if we pretend as if we did not receive from the Lord, is why we are going to do what? Exhort ourselves against others. Altogether. So every good that we have today, whether it is some sort of charismatic gift, whether it is looks, whether it is heights, whether it is what and what, it is the Lord who has done what? Given. So, the simplicity of his message is that we have no good but what we have done, what? Received from God. That is to mean that the honor and the glory goes back to who? To God. All men have received from the Lord. Are we together? And all of us are not the same. And those differences, the varieties that the Lord has made amongst men, he made them for his own glory. Now, just look at that verse 7 alone with the competition some of you know amongst ministers. Would it have been there if they were reading through the book of Corinthians? You cannot read from Corinthians and then you do what? You allow all of these things that we do have today. In the ESV version it says, "For who sees anything different in you? What do you have that you did not receive? If then you received it, why do you boast as if you did not receive?" Altogether, self-reflection. Ministers should be regarded as what? As servants. Congregants should not do what? Hype the ministers. But the congregants are not going to hype the ministers until the ministers teach them not to. Are we clear on that? Okay, verses 8. In 8 it says, "Now you are what?" Now he goes into, you know, a language that is known as a language of a sarcastic language. Where you now begin to be funny on people. Sarcasm. You say something that you don't mean. Altogether. So now he goes into that language in verses 8 by saying, "Already, you Corinthians, you have all you want." Because now for you, you think you're very special. Now he goes into sarcasm. He says, "Already you have become rich without us." Is it true? No. It is the apostles that declared. So this is a funny language playing on them. Eh? And then he has him to say, "Without us, you have become kings." How can a believer know that he's a king? It is only when the apostles tell you that we have not become kings and what? And priests. But now if you begin not to listen to the ones who told you, then he says, "Minus us, you are that, Mnangi." He has him to say that in verses 8, "And would that you did reign, so that we might do what? Share the role with you. For I think that God has exhibited us apostles at the last of all, like men sentenced unto death, because we have become spectacles to the world, to angels, and to men." Look at verses 10. "We are fools for Christ's sake, but you are wise in Christ. We are weak, but you are strong. You are held in honor, but we in disrupt. To the present hour we hunger and thirst. We are poorly dressed, buffeted, and homeless, and we labor working with our own hands. You see these guys, why they were not looking for men to exalt them? They were working with what? But today the ones who do not work with their own hands, who depend on what people have given unto them, they want all the praises. Because of the too much what? Tithe things they receive from the people, the first fruits and all of those other things that they have now made. Very substantial thing that if you don't do them, therefore a curse will come upon you. The apostles say that we live the way we live. The Lord meant it so. Altogether? So, everything that is to do with the apostles, living in poverty and all of that, the Lord permitted it to happen to them to get his own glory. And those very things that they were having, they were going through, the sufferings, made the Corinthians to think that the apostles were genuine. They were not used of the Lord. Altogether. Remember, people are looking for what? Face a particular sign. So if you don't come with an expensive suit on you, they say, now how can you say that the Lord is using you? So the apostle is saying, for us we were poorly what? Dressed. Altogether. But one thing that is very important here for you to understand, you Corinthians, God is the main person behind all of this. He permitted that our life should be the way they are to get his own glory. But the message we have goes beyond those other ministers of yours that you've lifted up. Altogether. So, Paul in one or the other tries to beat down the pride that was in what? In the Corinthians, thinking that the ones who are used of the Lord, they should have a particular appearance. Altogether. And now one thing he does, he goes for a particular appearance that was actually nowhere close. And I'm telling you today, that thing can happen. If you go into some assembly poorly dressed and they say you are the person going to minister in these prosperity gatherings, mm-hmm. and they say you are the one to teach, some people might begin to wonder, so what is he going to communicate? First of all, he's suffering from positive confession. The second thing, he doesn't know who he is in Christ. The other thing, this guy doesn't know that he's a king. But look at this guy. The guys that were poorly dressed, they are writings. There's not any writing in all of our time that has ever come close to theirs. That means that physical things should be done what? Abandoned. Altogether. If God has blessed you with good clothing, if God has blessed you with a number of good stuff, you should not elevate those. You should not make them as the main what? The main thing. Altogether. So, Paul says he went into listing all the hardships that the apostles had to go through to show them that genuine apostles of the Lord, these were some of the things that they went through, but they never exalted themselves. But today, the ones who are not genuine, they say, what do they say now? To them, they say, if you are weak, therefore the Spirit of the Lord is not working in you. If you are not honorable, probably you have nothing that people see as an honor to you. If you are despised, therefore you have nothing to share. If you are poorly dressed, therefore, you know, you are the Lord is not using you altogether. But remember one thing that Paul says, God has made us to become a spectacle, not only to the world, but also to the angels, and also to what? To all men. He did it for his own glory. Altogether. Remember where we came from in chapter 1. God gets people who appear not to be with anything that actually can be esteemed, and then he gets what? His own glory. So out of the lives of the apostles and everything that is to do with their appearance, he did a much more greater work with them than any of us we shall ever. Remember, the foundation of the church was laid by who? By the apostles and the prophets. What was their style of putting on? Animal skins and all of that. But let me tell you, that church is stable. So the naivety of the body of Christ today is to think that the external thing does what? Is the standard of how one is being what? Used. No wonder the devil has lied to so many what? Congregations. Verses 11. Even in the present hour, we both hunger and thirst, and naked, and are buffeted, and have no certain dwelling places. Did they know positive confession? Speak well. If you want to be rich, say that I am rich, I am rich. The apostle has nothing, has no place of dwelling. Jesus himself said what? The Son of Man has nowhere to do what? To lay his head. Altogether, foxes and birds, they have where to lay, but the Son of Man has no. But to them, you hear them, Jesus had a mansion. In fact, it is because he was very busy that he never went back to his mansion. That is what they say.
But I'm telling you, Jesus was born in a poor family. They didn't even have an outstanding sacrifice for those that are rich. They gave him turtle doves as a sacrifice. And now they say he became poor so that you can become this and that altogether. But look at the apostles. These apostles came after the death and the resurrection. They were living in the New Testament. Mm-hmm. Why are the lives of the apostles unique from the ministers today, unique from the modern day gospel today? That means someone has gone beyond that which is written. And the church has accepted it and has called it what? The gospel. Mm-hmm. We need to live normally. But this thing of wanting to prove that God works in your life, you're going to lie to people, you're going to begin to borrow, you're going to do what? To begin to lie about so many things altogether. I don't know. There are several people that have given false testimonies just to make their pastors feel nice. Praise the Lord, brethren. The Lord did, after doing a lot of funny things out there. Those are all wrong word things. Verses now what? 12. Laboring and working with our own hands. Laboring and working with our own hands. If you take away the tithing, you take away the first fruits, most ministers will go back to their villages. Why? They depend on those. That's why they have put a curse word on it. If you do not give it, something is going to come on you. They don't work with their hands. They don't start their own. People are the ones struggling. Poor women, poor men who work in so many places that are actually, you cannot imagine, they give the little thing to those people. And then tomorrow they say, see how the Lord has blessed me. Those are all bad things. The apostles worked with their hands. They started their own things. Paul was a tent maker. He started that. And when he was not there, we don't know. The Bible says that being revealed, but we bless, being persecuted, and we suffer, being defamed, we entreat, we are made as what? The filth of the world, and the offscouring of all things unto this day. Now, he goes into verses 14 to explain the reason for why he wrote the way he wrote. Look at verses now. In 14, he says what? He says, I really think not to shame you. Who wants his minister when he's poorly dressed? When he's defamed, when he has nowhere to sleep. These are things that the congregants first deal with to make sure that their pastor has where to sleep. Their pastor puts on where he looks nice. Paul said that, I have not written all these things to shame you, but one thing he wanted to do was to warn. Look at the scripture. He said that, but as what? My beloved sons, I warn you. Don't go by any of those things. The substantiality of their message was the main thing. Their message was evidently enough by even how the apostles lived. It is us that have taken things out of context to begin to say that if a person is defamed, if a person has nowhere to sleep, that person, maybe the Lord is not using him. That is how we have followed the teachings that are to do with the imagined church. My dear ones, has the church hearkened to the warning that was given to the Corinthians? Hasn't the church gone above that which is written? Hasn't the church made the ministers to look as masters? Hasn't the church made ministers to be puffed against one another? Yes, the warning to the Corinthians has not been taken heed by the mainstream church. Now here is where the bomb comes in. Paul, after having given the reason as to why he wrote the way he wrote, the Bible mentions something very important in verses 10 now. For though you have countless guides, King James says that for though you have 10,000 instructors in Christ, you do not have many fathers. You do not have many what? Fathers. Fathers always start. The apostle here started what? The church of Corinth. All other teachers that came after the Apostle Paul, all together under the ranks of that same apostlehood, could not match, could not be in the same rank like the ones who laid what? The foundation. You and I will never be equal with those apostles. We are instructors that build upon. Remember in chapter 3, someone has laid, but the one that buildeth upon. So now the ones that they had seen later, they began to hype them more than the ones that laid what? The foundation. And now he says, you can have many instructors, but you do not yet have many fathers. All together. I and my son, we are equal in nature.
He has the same DNA, but he does not equal in my position. I remain above him. So the nature, we can be the same. Like Jesus was equally on the same platform with the Father and the Spirit altogether. But position-wise, when he came here on earth, the Father was above. That is why he was always depending on his Father. So nature is the most important thing, but there is also what is known as the position. Get what I'm saying? You can have all the degrees, but you can never equal your Father as far as position is concerned. But the DNA nature is nature to nature. Altogether, you are equal. But position. So out of the 12 tribes of Israel, there are people who are greater. Abraham is greater. Isaac is greater. Jacob is greater. Because all of these ones came from what?
From them.
So position-wise, they are greater. Nature to nature, they are equal. And so that is why some people today ask that question, that now if Jesus was indeed God, why was he always saying that he was praying in his Father's name? That is the main thing. His position was somehow downward, lowered when he came down. But as far as his nature is concerned, everything he remained with it. Altogether, he remained God. At the same time, he was also what? Man. But calling him God, that is why in the Gospels you see people would worship him and you do not say, don't do that like the apostles did in Acts 14. He would accept worship because he was God. 100% God and then 100% what? Man. So now here, these other, the Corinthians and you that are receiving this message, we are building on the foundation. We cannot equal with the ones that God used to do what? To lay the foundation. That is why even their names are there in Revelation 21:14. You know, your name is not there. And my name is not there. We all know that. So now here it means fatherhood in the Bible is not positional. It is relational. Get what I'm saying? When you hear that so-and-so is my spiritual father, it is not positional but relational. Being able to serve to what? One another. A person you lead to the Lord and you are still able to communicate with him on a lowly level, that is a person that can call you the Father in the Lord. The one you led to what? To the Lord. But now, why we call it not positional but relational? Remember, Jesus came to serve. And service is what? Relational. By the church today, these ones who want the praises of men, they are put it in position. Ah, the man is very far. He comes in a tinted fire. For him, he's seeing you from inside, but for you, you're not seeing him. Bishop is coming. So, they cannot carry their Bibles. Their Bibles are too heavy. So, those are the ones that have taken it to position. I am too big. I can no longer even carry my Bible. But if it is on a level of relationship, you live as other people. So now look at verses 16. 16, he says what?
I urge you to be imitators.
Why was Paul saying what he said? Why was he saying what he was saying? Because he was indeed following Christ. All together. There's a teaching we did that is to do with the kind of a minister one ought to follow. The example of it is 1 Corinthians. Look at 1 Corinthians 11:1. 1 Corinthians 11:1. Why would people have to follow Paul? And why should we follow a minister that are in the character of Paul? He says in 1 Corinthians 11:1, be ye followers of me, even as I also do what? Follow Christ. That is to mean that if any person goes beyond the writing of the apostles, that person is not following Christ. Don't follow him. We follow a person following who? Christ. If a person stops to follow Christ by following the apostolic writing, that person, you shouldn't do what? You shouldn't do what? Follow him. John chapter 10 verses 4. And when he putteth forth his own sheep, he goes before them, and the sheep do what? Follow him, for they know his voice. How do believers know the voice of God? By the writings of what? The scriptures. If believers are not built onto the foundation of the scriptures, they are going to seek for voices outside scriptures. They are going to fall into the hands of what? Of the wolves. And the wolves, you know one thing they do. They tear you completely. Let us also consider Philippians. In Philippians chapter 3, verse 17. Brethren, be followers together of me, and mark them which walk so as you have us for an example. In
anyone going beyond that, wanting to be a master, wanting to be puffed against another, what else did we consider? Any individual that begins to judge and say that because someone has this and all of that, maybe that person has the praise of God. No, that person has the praise of what? Of men. Paul says that is not true. Don't look out for that as an example. That person has gone what? Way beyond. So that is one of the things that we need also. First Peter, let us also consider 1 Peter 5:3. Not domineering over those in your charge, but being example to what? To the flock. Why would that one be? Because verse 4 says what? When the chief shepherd appears, you will receive unfading what? Crown of glory. The message is the same. In 17 it says, for this cause I have sent you Timothy, who is my beloved son, and a faithful in what? In the Lord, shall bring you into remembrance of my ways, which be in Christ, as I teach everywhere and in every church. What is the apostle trying to say? If the Corinthians had gone wrong in not knowing how they should conduct themselves, he says he's going to send who?
Timothy.
And what is the main work of Timothy? Timothy is to correct the abuse that has gone in the church. He is to correct the abuse that has gone into the church of what? Of the Corinthians. Because Paul says he's my beloved son. I trust him. When he comes, he'll remind you of my ways in Christ. Was Timothy going to contradict anything of Paul? No. Why? Because he's a beloved son and faithful. And look at the ways of Paul. Were they only to the church of Corinth or to every church? A minister's life should be what? Consistent. Whether you are in Gulu, whether in Kampala, if you are not supposed to be a lord in Gulu, you are not supposed to be a lord in what? In Kampala. You don't say, now we are in Kampala, these people here, they are different. Now I want to be like a master. No, you are the same. Even if you go to the farthest village in some part of the world, you remain the same.